Half-a-day students, I am Governor Lou Leon Guerrero. You all have been through a year of big changes. We've had to adapt and make big changes to keep our families and our island safe. But with change comes opportunity and a chance to try new things like PBS University. While Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio and I will continue to do our part to keep our island safe, you students have a part to play as well. Your part is to keep learning and to keep up with your lessons. That's why I am happy to see you here ready to learn with PBS University. PBS University is a way to bring a continuous educational curriculum to you while you stay safe at home during this time. To help you keep up with your studies, we asked our friends at PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education to put together this episode. Thank you for doing your part and have a great lesson.
PBS University is a program by PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education in conjunction with public school teachers. These lessons are created to provide both parents and students with a unique educational experience while helping students to continue learning at home. PBS University, next on PBS Guam.
1, 2, 3, 4!
Come along, let's sing a song, we'll have a great adventure.
Today's the day, let's learn and play,
we'll have a great adventure.
Numbers,
letters,
science things, all that we can do. Help you deal with how you feel, share with us too.
It's super cool and just like school,
our awesome learning adventures. So grab a friend, the fun will end, our awesome learning adventures. Learning adventures with PBS University.
Half a day and aloha, which is hello and goodbye in Hawaii. I'm Mrs. Borja, your 3rd through 5th grade literacy teacher. I love friends and balloons and fun, and I hope you do too, because here we go. My friends and family threw me a surprise birthday party. It was so much fun. You know, if I had known about it, I would have invited all of you, but I'm glad you're here now. So I got some really cool birthday presents and I need to write some thank you notes, and I thought it would be a perfect time to go over some of the most commonly misspelled words. And by the end of this video, you should be able to say, I can correctly use some commonly misspelled homophones in my writing. The reason why these words are often misspelled is because they are homophones, which means they sound the same, but they have different meanings, and they're spelled differently. When we're talking, they sound the same, so spelling doesn't matter. But when we're writing, spelling matters, because you might write or type the wrong word, and that will change the meaning. Let me show you what I mean. Listen to these two words. Your and your. Your and your. They sound exactly the same, don't they? Now, let's look at them. They're spelled differently, and they mean two completely different things. Y-O-U-R means ownership. That means it shows that something belongs to you. That is your cat. Oh, are these your cookies? Y-O-U apostrophe R-E is a contraction, which usually is two words that have been shortened and kind of glued together with an apostrophe. Y-O-U apostrophe R-E is a shortened version of you are. So, you're so fun, which means you are so fun. Or, you're my favorite student, which means you are my favorite student. But don't tell anyone else that you're my favorite. If you use the wrong one, it changes the meaning of what you're saying. If you mean to tell your friend that you like his shoes, but you type Y-O-U apostrophe R-E, shoes are cool, what he might think you're saying is, you are shoes are cool. Which doesn't really make sense at all, does it? So we have to make sure that we know just which one to use at the right time. Okay, so look at this cool gift my friend Michelle gave me. Art supplies. There's some paper. Ooh, markers. Ooh, and look, colorful pencils too. She knows that I really love making art. And I've already started making a thank you letter for her, but I'd like you to help me finish writing it. Michelle, thank you for blank gift. You know I love drawing. Blank's such a great friend. Let's draw together soon. So, which one goes where? Yes, great job. Y-O-U are gift because it is the gift that Michelle gave me. And Y-O-U apostrophe R-E, such a great friend, means you are such a great friend. Awesome. This one gets a little trickier because there are three of them. Listen, there, there, there. They all sound the same, don't they? But they don't look the same or mean the same. T-H-E-R-E is pretty much a location. Where? There. T-H-E-I-R is ownership. So that's their dog, or their mom is coming to pick them up in an hour. And T-H-E-Y apostrophe R-E is another contraction, which means they are. Roller skates! These are from my mom. Cool, huh? Here's my note so far. Dear mom, thank you for the roller skates. Blank, so cool. My friends will be excited when I take the skates to the park and show them to everyone. Blank. I can't wait to see all blank faces when I let them take a spin. Go ahead and put the correct words in the right spaces. If you did this, then you're correct. T-H-E-Y apostrophe R-E, so cool. Show them to everyone, T-H-E-R-E, and T-H-E-I-R faces. There are so many other words that are also often misspelled because they are homophones. For example, let's look at two, and two. T-O shows direction. Give this to your teacher. T-O-O kind of means a lot, like, I ate too much. And T-W-O is the number. So I think we have enough time to finish one more thank you card together for this gift. Ooh, a cube puzzle. Here's what I have so far. Dear Richie, thank you so much for the cube puzzle. You are blank kind. I don't know how to solve these yet, but I'm excited blank learn. And we should have picked T-O-O for the first one and T-O for the second one. If you got it right, great job. And if you didn't, keep practicing. I know it can get confusing sometimes, but the more you practice reading and writing, the easier it will get to remember how to correctly spell these homophones. Thank you to all of you for visiting me and helping me write my thank you cards. And happy birthday to all of you, whether it's a belated birthday wish or an early birthday wish, or if today is your birthday. Either way, I hope this year your birthday wishes come true. See you next time, and until then, be good, read books. Bye!
Welcome to PBS University, everyone. I'm Mr. B, your 3rd through 5th grade math teacher. To get started, I'd like to share something that I just learned. It's a Chinese greeting for hello. Ni hao. Say it with me. Ni hao. Awesome. Now, speaking of awesome, are you ready for another awesome learning adventure? Well, I hope you are, because today we're going on a field trip to the UOG Research and Education Center. But before we go, is there anything around here that might be a clue to what we might see or do up there? Did you notice the Be Happy book on the shelf? And did you see the other Mr. B sitting next to me? Oh, and did you hear the bees buzzing around? Well, if you noticed any of those things, then those are all clues that we're going to visit the honeybees and our friends from the Guam Beekeepers Association. So come along, let's take a ride up to the beautiful village of Cebu. Honeybees are amazing insects. They are incredible examples of how to be a good member of a community. Each member does its job to help the community live and grow. They're also very important to plants. The bees help the plants pollinate. That means that they carry pollen from one plant to another so there can be new plants. Animals and other living things, like us, we eat the delicious honey the bees make. These are just a few ways they show us what great helpers they are. Today, they're going to help us practice division. How do you think they can do that? Well, the bees are going to help us use division to create equal groups. Well, here we are. Let's check out the bees and see just how they can help. Now, we're going to do our best to not upset the bees. Let's not make them mad, okay? So we have to be very gentle with them. And if we do that, then we'll be fine. And we won't get stung. Let's try not to get stung, okay? But just to be safe, I'm going to put on this bee suit because I don't know. I don't want to get stung. Do you? No. All right. Okay. Here we go. A community of honeybees is called a colony. In nature, their houses are called hives. The beekeepers use wooden boxes and frames to make hives for the thousands of bees that need a place to live. Here's where we practice division. But I think so that we can get our brains going, let's do a simple addition problem, okay? Here we go. What do you get when you add 2 bees and 3 bees? Five bees. Get it? No? Sorry. Okay, sorry. Bad joke. Sorry. Okay, let's get back to it. Here's where we practice division, all right? So the beekeepers are making hives with 30 frames and 3 boxes. How many frames does each box hold? Well, let's use what we know to make a division number sentence. We know the total number of frames they're using. That's 30, which means 30 is our dividend. So write that first. We also know that there are 3 boxes. If we think of each box as a group, then we have 3 groups. So write the 3 next. Pop quiz time! What part of the division number sentence is the number 3? I heard it. Someone said it. The divisor. That's right. Okay, we have our dividend and divisor. Now we can find the answer, the quotient. To find the quotient, we need to divide or separate the frames into equal groups. I have an idea. How about we go get some help from the beekeepers for this part? What we learn from them is that if we divide the 30 frames by the three boxes, then each box will have 10 frames. And did you see how many bees are on just one frame? Can you imagine how many are in an entire colony? That is a lot of bees. But lots of bees means lots of delicious honey. Whoa, this honey is amazing. And I'm sure my family would love to try some of this delicious local honey. Let's stop by the Guam Bee Company and get some. I got 8 jars of honey here, and I have 4 people I want to share with. How many jars will each person get? We can definitely do some division here. The division problem looks like this. 8 divided by 4, or 8 jars divided by 4 people. That will give us 4 groups of 2. So 8 divided by 4 equals 2. Each person will get 2 jars. I'm sure they're going to love it. That's our lesson on using division to create equal groups. A very special thank you to Mr. Chris Rosario and Ms. Olympia Terral from the Guam Beekeepers Association. Thank you also to Rod Greeno from the Guam Bee Company for that delicious local honey. And of course, thank you so much to those amazing honeybees. Thanks, Mr. Bee. You know, there's so much more to do and learn up there at the GIGO Research and Education Center. I definitely want to go back again. I'd love for you all to join me for that and so many more awesome learning adventures. See you then.
Talofa, boys and girls. Welcome back to PBS University. Talofa means hello in Samoa. My name is Mrs. Christine Pama, and I am your 3rd, 4th, and 5th grade science teacher. I don't know if you noticed, but all of the items on my table are actually very important to me because they matter. I made a funny. They really do matter because today we are going to talk about matter. Everything around us is matter, and matter is made up of molecules. What is a molecule? Molecules are made up of a bunch of tiny little atoms, which are like the smallest, tiniest unit of matter that forms a chemical element. Super tiny. Matter is anything that takes up space. There are 3 types of matter: solids, liquids, and gases. Solids have a definite shape and take up a certain amount of space, like this cup. Solid. Also solid. Solids keep their shape, and if you heat up a solid object, it'll probably turn into a liquid. The molecules are so close together in a solid object. Liquids don't keep their shape. It will only take the shape of its container and will take up a certain amount of space, like my tea or this glittery lava lamp. When you heat up liquid, it will turn into a gas. It can also turn back into a solid when it is cooled, like water turning into ice. The molecules are very loosely packed, like this. The 3rd one is gas. Gas is something you and I can't see. It has no definite shape and doesn't take a definite amount of space. It will, however, take up the shape of a solid container or in liquid and can freely move around. The molecules and gases are very spaced out. So what are the three kinds of matter? Solids, liquids, and gases. Very good. But did you know that matter has three basic properties? It's volume, mass, and shape. Volume is the amount of space it takes up. Is it big or is it small? Mass is the amount of matter the object has. And shape? Well, it's shape. These are called physical properties. What does it look like? How does it feel? What does it smell like? And what does it taste like? Solids can be rough, smooth, soft, hard, big, small, cold, or hot. Liquids can be gooey, slimy, sticky, wet, smooth, hot, or cold. Gases can be foggy, clear, transparent, or look light or heavy. Can you tell me if this is a solid, liquid, or gas and mention some of its properties? This is a rock. Yes, it's a solid. It's hard, rough, and medium-sized. How about this? It's gas, carbon dioxide. You can't really see it, but it's there. How about this? This one is a tricky one. It is gas combined with liquid. The sticky stuff inside the hairspray is the liquid, and the pressurized gas inside forces the liquid out when you press the button. All right, guys, it's time for an experiment. You will need a clear plastic cup, an Alka-Seltzer tablet, water, and I'm going to include food coloring to make it a little more exciting. All three types of matter can be seen. The solid matter is the plastic cup and the Alka-Seltzer tablet. The liquid is the water. Let's see what happens when we drop the tablet in the water.
Wow! Do you see the bubbles forming? When the Alka-Seltzer tablet is dropped in the water, it causes a chemical reaction. The ingredients in the tablet mixes together and forms carbon dioxide bubbles.
Now let's see something solid turn into a liquid and then turn into gas when you apply heat. You will need a stove, some ice cubes, a cooking pan, and an adult. That part is very important. Now let's identify the materials. The pan and ice cubes are solid. That's about it. Now let's turn on the heat. As you can see, the ice is already melting and turning into a liquid, which is water. If I leave the heat on, the liquid eventually evaporates and turns into water vapors, which is the gas matter. Now, how can we make a solid turn into a liquid and turn back into a solid? You will need a candle, some wax paper, a match or a lighter, and an adult. When I apply the heat by lighting the candle, the wax melts. Once the wax is removed from the heat, it begins to cool and solidify again. That's pretty solid. All right, kids, I would like to make a joke about solids, liquids, and gases, but it's no laughing matter. I have a joke about dark matter, but you can't see it. That was totally funny. What's the matter with you? I hope you had a lot of fun learning about matter. I sure did, and I'm happy you were laughing at my jokes. If you found those experiments really exciting, do it again with an adult. I hope I can see you demonstrate your skills about solids, liquids, and gases. And until then, remember, you are so smart, so awesome, so special, and you so matter. Goodbye!
Half a day, students. Welcome to PBS University. My name is John Fernandez, and I'm the superintendent of the Guam Department of Education. These PBS University lessons are made to help you to continue learning. The teachers here prepared fun lessons on science, character education, math, English, and more. And they made it for you, the students of Guam. We're very grateful to them for their instruction. We're also thankful for you students, parents, and guardians who are watching. Remember, stay safe and healthy, and we'll see you soon in the next school year. Thank you.
Everyone, happy and welcome to Mrs. Kianchan's grades 3rd through 5th social studies class. Now today, I'm just about ready to go out, but right now it is summer, and you know what summer means? It is hot. So as I get ready to get out and explore our beautiful island, I'm making sure to have something to cover my head and some sunblock. And the most important, a camera to document what I'm learning. Now, today, for our class lesson, we are going to learn a little about the Yapis culture. Now, the Yapis are from the state of Yap, which is part of the Federated States of Micronesia. Now, do you know what they use as part of their currency? It's not dollar bills. It's something a little more different. It's shaped like a disc and has a hole in the middle and it's pretty heavy to carry. Do you know what it is? Well, let's go find out a little more about the Yapis people, their currency, their clothing, and their language. Let's go! Let's learn about the Yapis culture. Yap is part of the Federated States of Micronesia. It is located southwest of the island of Guam. This is the official flag of the state of Yap. It is a white star circled by a white traditional sailing canoe enclosed by a white circle centered in a field of blue. Now this flag showcases their sailing canoe on the blue ocean, along with a star that represents them as one of the states of the Federated States of Micronesia. And if you look closely, the big circle and the small circle encircling the star represents the Rai, as Yap is also called the Island of Stone Money. In today's agenda, we will be talking more about their clothing, their currency, and some simple phrases of their language. This is the Yapis traditional wear for males. It varies through their ages. The young boys start out wearing a piece of clothing called a thu. And gradually, they add more cloths as they get older. The older males wear a kafar outfit, which is comprised of hibiscus fibers, a baggy, and loin cloths. Here we see the traditional wear of females in Yap. When a girl is young, she wears a grass skirt called the oneg, made of ferns, banana leaves, and some other kinds of grasses. When she reaches puberty, she is required to wear a black string called a marfa around her neck, which literally means she has reached her womanhood. Leis in Yap are also called nunu. The Yapis people used a very unique form of currency back in the day. It was called the Rai stone. Yapis use limestone discs that are limited in resource, which makes it valuable to their island. These stones came from Palau. Each stone was different in size and in weight. Some stones can weigh up to more than 200 pounds. It was very difficult to move. So holes were carved in the center of the stone to help carry it around the island. Now, stone money is mainly used for traditional or ceremonial uses such as offering for a hand in marriage, or as an apology, or for politics. The Yap Islands now use the US dollar as its form of currency for everyday transactions. So in the Yapis culture, the stone money was used as an exchange for goods and services. In that, if they were to exchange money because there was no bank transaction, what they would do is they would hold a public announcement and they would say who owns what stone. So they would be like, Johnny owns that stone. So even if there was no bank transaction or no paper trail, because everybody was part of the announcement, even if that person passed away, everyone would know who owns the stone. Isn't that amazing? Now here are some simple phrases with other language. For hello, we say mogithin. For how are you, we say ke or gomboch. Thank you, kamagar. Yes, aragon. I'm sorry, siro. Goodbye, kafel. Just about done putting on my sunblock to protect my skin from the summer sun. Now, wasn't that an interesting lesson about the Yapis people? Their money is not dollar bills, but what is it? Stone money. What an interesting fact. And that stone money stays on their island. It doesn't leave, and it has value to them because it is very limited, and it has to be brought over from Pohnpei, another FSM island. How interesting to value stone money. I think that is a very interesting part of their culture. Now, everyone, I hope you enjoyed today's lesson on the Yapis culture. And as we continue to embrace cultural diversity, let's ask questions to learn more about the people in our island, how they respect people, and how we can respect them. Till next time, enjoy your summer and be safe out there.
Annyeong! That means hello in Korean. Hey guys, Ms. Torres here, your fifth grade teacher with PBS University. And boy, do I feel some good vibes coming my way. Thanks so much for joining me today. Have you been kind to yourself since the last time we were together? How about those breathing techniques? You know, a little practice goes a long way in keeping a healthy body and a healthy mind. And guess what? You are so ready to spread your kindness to others again. What do you got to do? Well, just choose what you want to do. And here are some ways that you can commit to making a difference. No ifs, ands, or buts. You have everything you need to be a change maker. But just don't take my word for it.
Hi, helpers. Do you know that you can be a change maker? Change makers work to make the world a better place. Every person can make change by standing up for what is right, like making rules fair for everyone, keeping our earth clean, and helping people in need. Change makers can be activists, nonprofit workers, volunteers, and even kids. Some famous change makers are Martin Luther King Jr., who helped make rules fair for people of all skin colors, Jane Goodall, who helped protect chimpanzees, and Malala Yousafzai, who helped girls around the world to go to school. Kids can help make the world better too. We are never too young to be change makers.
To learn more about Meet the Helpers, visit meetthehelpers.org.
Meet the Helpers is made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a private corporation funded by the American people.
And it starts with the thought of wanting to help. Or maybe it comes from a challenge that you or someone close to you has faced. You know, don't limit yourself. I mean, think outside the box. Be creative. Be inventive. Let's check out what these change makers are doing to make a difference in their community.
Hi, my name is Taryn. I am a kid and I am a helper. One of the best ways we could be helpers is by being kind and caring to the people we meet.
Hi.
Kids can be helpers in many ways. We could speak up if something is wrong. We could donate toys or food. We can make thoughtful notes or pictures. And with the help of caring grown-ups in our lives, we can even help by volunteering in our neighborhoods. You can keep helping as you get bigger, and you might even choose to become a grown-up helper, like a 911 operator, teacher, doctor, or even a president. Kids are important helpers in our neighborhood because we are the future.
To meet other helpers in our neighborhood, go to meetthehelpers.org.
Meet the Helpers is made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a private corporation funded by the American people.
Have you ever wondered what you can do to help our planet? Well, I'm about to meet some kids who found a simple way to make a difference. Come on! Queen, Siren, and Veronica are members of the Green Team at PS 110, a green flag eco school in Brooklyn, New York.
I wanted to be part of the Green Team because I wanted to change the environment and make it a healthier place, and this school too.
When they started working together, they looked at their school's environmental habits to figure out what they needed to do better.
Our first audit included looking at the garbage bins and the lunchroom system to see how everything was working, so we knew what we could make better and what was already good.
They decided to focus on a big problem: waste. Did you know that most Americans make more than 4 pounds of trash every day? That can add up to hundreds of millions of tons of garbage each year. Most of this trash is taken to landfills, where it's buried in the ground, often releasing harmful gases when it breaks down. But a lot of it is stuff that could be reused in different ways. Recycling is when you collect stuff that you would normally throw out, like plastic bottles or paper, and use it to make something new. Composting is when you recycle natural waste, like food scraps or leaves, to make fertilizer that helps more plants grow. Recycling and composting mean less waste in landfills and fewer harmful gases polluting our air. Recycling also saves natural resources and uses less energy than making completely new stuff, all leading to a healthier planet. The Green Team figured out that a few small changes could help their school to recycle and compost more. Because hallways did not have landfill bins, students were throwing regular trash into the hallway recycling bins.
When we did our audit, we saw like a lot of landfill was ending up in the recycling bins.
Which might not sound like such a bad thing, but actually it is. That leaves the recycling facility people with something that they don't know what to do with. So it just ends up getting incinerated.
So the girls decided to add hallway bins for regular garbage.
We made posters to show the kids where the landfill plastic metal should go. And it worked because this year now they know where to put things.
Every week, they check the bins to make sure people are sorting their trash correctly. What's the weirdest thing you found?
One time we were checking the classroom bins. Mm-hmm. We looked in the recycling bin. Banana.
There was a banana in the recycling bin?
Yeah.
That's crazy. Lunchtime waste was also a problem. As part of a program called Cafeteria Culture, the Green Team organizes student monitors who help kids sort their lunch waste into landfill, compost, and recycling bins. The Green Team wanted to make sure everyone in their school understood how to sort their waste correctly. So Queen has been teaching younger kids about recycling and composting.
So now we're gonna play a game, okay? Where does this spoon go?
Plastic bin.
Mm-hmm. Through changes like these, Queen, Siren, Veronica, and their school have really made a difference for the environment.
You don't need permission to try to make the world a better place. Just do it.
Want to make a difference too? You can recycle and compost, and make sure your friends and family are doing it too. Maybe you can form a Green Team to make change at your school, just like Queen, Siren, and Veronica did. Let's get started.
So as our time ends today, please remember, to build positive character, it starts with you being kind to you first. You need some time to relax, but you gotta have some fun too. Stay true to your feelings and use what you've learned to deal with those challenges. Because when you take that risk to help someone in your community who needs a helping hand, it's going to be so worth it. So until next time, kindness matters. Bye.
Half a day, Rana Nim, Ali, and Kumusta from your very own third grade through fifth grade Chamorro teacher, Senor Al, and of course, our special friend, Pompey. Pompey, why don't you say hello to our PBS friends?
Half a day to our Chamorro friends, Rana Nim to our Chukis friends, Ali to our Palawan friends, and Kumusta to our Filipino friends.
Thank you, Pompey. Now, PBS friends, today we are going to share with all of you the things in the house in Chamorro. As you all know, a house has many rooms, and today we are going to practice saying one object that belongs in each room. Let's start with the kitchen. In the kitchen, or the cocina, as we learned in the last episode, we have a stove. A stove in Chamorro is fogon. Fogon. Now everyone knows that a fogon is hot when in use. So let me remind you to be safe when using the fogon. Pompey, can you say fogon with our PBS friends?
Sure, Señor Al. Fogon. Fogon. I have a fogon, but the one my mom uses is a gas fogon.
Yes, Pompey. Many people use the gas fogon to conserve power. I use the gas fogon also. Friends, is your fogon run by gas or electricity? Now, let's go to the next room that we learned in the last episode. Famagasizan, which means laundry room. Now, in the laundry room, the object we will learn is a washer or a washing machine. A washer or a washing machine is called makinan mamagasi. Makinan mamagasi. Pompey, can you say that with our PBS friends?
Sure, Señor Al. Come on, friends, join me in saying makinan mamagasi. Are you ready? Makinan mamagasi. Makinan mamagasi.
Great job, Pompey and friends.
Señor Al, I remember the next room we learned in that last lesson. It's garage, and it means sagang kareta.
You're right, Pompey. Garage does mean sagang kareta. Awesome job remembering. The object we will learn is kareta, which means car. Kareta. Kareta. Pompey, can you say that with our PBS friends?
Come on, friends. Let's show Señor Al how smart we are. Say kareta with me. Kareta. Kareta. Wow, Señor, I'm so proud of them.
Me too, Pompey. I'm so proud of them. Friends, do you remember what is the last room we learned in the last lesson? You're right. It's aposento. Aposento means bedroom. Now, the object we will learn in the aposento is a lamp or a light, which means candit. Candit. Pompey, can you say candit with our PBS friends?
Sure, Señor Al. Come on, friends, let's practice saying light in Chamorro. Candit. Candit.
Let's review the things of the house that we learned. Fogon, stove. Makinan mamagasi, washing machine. Candit, lamp or light, and kareta, car. Now we're going to sing the same song we used in the last episode. But this time, let's change the lyrics so it can help us remember the things in the house. You're going to hear the word mungi, which means where. And on the last part of the song, we will sing Gaigiki Halam, Kusina, Famagasizan, Sagankareta, and Aposento. Are we ready? A uno, a dos, a uno, dos, tres. Mongi, mongi, mongi e for good. Mongi, mongi, mongi e for good. Mongi, mongi, mongi e for good. Gai gi gi kusina. Gai gi gi kusina. Mongi, mongi, e makanan mamagasi. Mongi, mongi, e makanan mamagasi. Mongi, mongi, imakanan mamagasi. Gaigi gi pamagasi zan. Gaigi gi pamagasi zan. Mongi, mongi, mongi ikandel. Mongi, mongi, mongi ikandel. Mongi, mongi, mongi ikandel. Gai gigi apusentu. Gai gigi apusentu. Mongi, mongi, mongi ikareta. Mongi, mongi, mongi ikareta. Mongi, mongi, mongi ikareta. Gai gigi sagan kareta. Gai gigi sagan kareta. Gai gigi sagan kareta. That concludes our song for today, boys and girls. Thank you for joining us. Pampai, would you like to say adios to the PBS friends?
Adios, PBS friends! Have an amazing day!
Adios!
Fast, fun facts! Fast, fun facts! With Mr. Ernest Ochoco.
Hi kids, this is Mr. Ernest Ochoco with another fast, fun fact. And I'm going to show you a reveal of something super cool. And it's about a creature that can save the world. They're called
bees.
All right, and I'm going to show you, reveal another thing. My two good friends here, Mr. Chris Rosario of the Rosary Beads, and also Miss Olympia Terral of the Terral Beads. Okay, and here we've got our fabulous beehive. Oh my gosh. Doesn't that blow your mind? It blows my mind. Okay, so we're gonna talk about these bees because they're super important to the survival of the world. Not just of Guam, of the world. Why is that, Chris?
Well, bees are pollinators, meaning they help plants grow. That's what makes them very important.
So they kind of like go to the flowers, right? And they get from the flowers the pollen?
They get the pollen.
And then they fly back?
And they fly back to the colony, or they fly back to another plant, and they deliver the pollen to another plant.
Are they aware that they're delivering? Are they like, oh, here's another plant, and then deliver it?
Sometimes, well, sometimes it just, the pollen accidentally falls to the other flower. And then that is what makes pollination. Oh. And that's what makes fruits.
Oh, wow.
Mm. You want to say something?
Yes, because one thing you need to know about bee bodies is they have lots of hairs. And so when the bees are flying through the flower, the pollen sticks on the hairs. And then when they go to the next flower, the other pollen sticks on their hairs, and they're spreading pollen all around for you and me.
And the entire human race, right?
We are the world.
We are the world. We are the beekeepers.
And so, the ones to make it
I think there's a copyright infringement already. So we need to go ahead and stop the We Are the World. But you know that you get it. You guys get it, right? The bees are the creatures that help the world continue to survive. So next time you see a bee, don't get mad and don't try to
try to swat them and kill them. Don't do that. Just leave them alone. Leave them alone because they're your friends. This is Mr. Ernest Ochoco with another fast, fun fact. Bye, guys.
Today, students, I'm Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. For more than a year now, you all have continued to wash your hands and watch your distance from others, and you've done a really great job wearing your masks. We know your parents and guardians have helped you to make these changes to keep yourself and your community safe. As Governor Leon Guerrero said, we are happy you are here. We want you to continue to learn and sharpen your skills with the help of PBS University. This program is the result of a collaborative effort. We couldn't do it alone. I'd like to thank the teachers and support staff of the Guam Department of Education and PBS Guam for their work and their commitment to our students. I'd also like to thank you, students, for participating at home. To your parents, I'd like to thank you for taking an active role in your child's education. We are all eager to return to a time when all of us can share and study together in person. Until then, we hope you learn something new from this PBS University instruction.